In the dawning of the King, He the theme of heaven's praises, robed in frail humanity. In our longing, in our darkness, now the light of life has come. Look to Christ who condescended, took on flesh to ransom us. Christ the Lord upon the tree, in the stead of ruined sinners, hangs the Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace unmeasured.
Good morning, everyone. It's great to be with you, and I'm very thankful that I'm sure as you are too, that we can meet together again, that we can be here in the building and worship God together. I'm very thankful for Charlie, for his warm welcome, and for your minister as well, for Jerry and his invitation to be here with you today. I've got an announcement to make for the boys and girls. Jerry asked me to ask you for next week to draw a picture of an angel and to bring it along with you. So for next week, for worship next week, draw a picture of an angel and bring it along with you. I believe there'll be a prize for the best one. So that's something for the boys and girls to do this week. Again, it's good to be back, but the service of worship will look slightly different today. We're not able to sing as usual, and we're not able to do things as normal. For instance, when the service is over, I just have to leave. I'll not be able to stay and to shake hands and to talk to you or anything. I look forward to being back and being able to do that in the future, but sadly we can't do that at the minute. We have come here today to worship God. And it's important to remember that as we come to worship God, we don't just come because we like to come. That is true, we enjoy coming together and worshiping. But that's not the main reason why we come here to worship. It's not just because we've done it for years and so we'll keep doing it. The reason we come here to worship today is because God actually calls us to come and to worship him. We read in his word in the Bible these words from Psalm 95 where it says, "Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are his people. We are the flock of his care." Let us worship God. Let us pray together. Almighty God, we gather here today to worship you, the only true and living God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that this day is a special day, that it is one day in seven which you have given us to rest from everything else in our life and to worship you. Father, we thank you how today reminds us that our purpose in this life is not just to make money and to work, nor is it just to shop and to buy material things, nor is it even just to play and to have fun. You, God, have made us for so much more. Although the things that we do throughout the week are good in themselves, you have made us, O God, to glorify you and to enjoy you, our great God, forever. Today, as we come here to worship you, we are reminded that you are worthy of all our praise and worship. You are greater than everything else in the entire universe. You alone are God, and with you no one else can compare. And so we come and we worship you, the eternal, almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We long to worship you more and more because you deserve everything that we have. Father, as we come into your holy presence, we are reminded that we are sinners. We break your laws. By our sinful nature, we love to rebel against you and try to run away from you. Oh, how foolish we are to rebel against you, our Creator. And how silly of us to try and run away from you, the only one who can give us life. Father, we confess all our sin to you today. We ask that according to your word, you would forgive us all our sin, as we repent of it and trust in your Son alone for salvation. Father, we know that our sins are many. Indeed, more times than we can number have we broken your law. Father, you've blessed us with your word, and we even know it so well, and yet we still often fail to obey you. Father, forgive us, we pray. Father, we thank you that you have not left us in our sin to die and to face your judgment. Father, we thank you that in love you chose to save us, not because of anything good in us, but because of your grace and for your glory. We thank you, Lord Jesus, of how when the time was right, you came into this world. You were born of the Virgin Mary. You lived on this life for over 30 years, and you suffered all the same sort of things that we suffer. Yet unlike us, you did not sin. Jesus, we thank you for your obedience. We thank you that you died in our place for our sin. We thank you that you rose again, that we may have the hope of everlasting life. We thank you, Jesus, that today you're alive, and today you're in heaven, at the right hand of God the Father, and there you pray for us, your church. And Holy Spirit, we thank you for how you've given us the Bible. We thank you for how you moved men long ago to write down your word. We thank you that we still have the Word of God before us in the Bible. We thank you that it continues to teach us all we need for life and for godliness. Father, we pray today that as we meet here, as we study your word, that we would know your blessing, that we would glorify and learn more about your Son, and that by your Spirit we would understand your word and be more ready to obey it. Father, we ask your help because we need you. We can't do it without you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to read together from God's word. If you have a Bible with you, please turn with me to the book of Acts in the New Testament. Our reading comes from Acts chapter 17 this morning in the book of Acts. Acts is a very important book in the New Testament. It comes in between the four Gospels at the beginning, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They tell us about Jesus' life on earth. And then the rest of the New Testament tells us about the church, how it spread and grew after Jesus went back to heaven. But Acts is sort of a bridge in between that. At the beginning, Jesus is still on earth, and then he ascends into heaven and sends his Spirit to the apostles and to the church so that they can tell others about Jesus. And so we read in chapter 17 about the Apostle Paul as he moves from town to town telling others about Jesus. Acts chapter 17, reading from verse 1. This is God's word. When they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue. As his custom was, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from the Scriptures, explaining and proving that Christ had to suffer and rise from the dead. "This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Christ," he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and not a few prominent women. But the Jews were jealous, so they rounded up some of the bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some other brothers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here also, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are all defying Caesar's decrees, saying that there is another king, one called Jesus." When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they put Jason and others on bail and let them go. As soon as it was night, the brothers sent Paul and Silas away to Berea. On arriving there, they went to the Jewish synagogue. Now, the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the Scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true. Many of the Jews believed, as did also a number of prominent Greek women and Greek men. When the Jews in Thessalonica learned that Paul was preaching the word of God at Berea, they went there too, agitating the crowds and stirring them up. The brothers immediately sent Paul to the coast, but Silas and Timothy stayed at Berea. The men who escorted Paul brought him to Athens and then left with instructions for Silas and Timothy to join him as soon as possible. Amen. We end our reading here, and we give thanks to God for this reading of his word. We know that we are blessed when we read it. Boys and girls here this morning, I wonder, who do you listen to? Who do you pay attention to? There are lots of people who talk to you all the time, but who do you listen to? Who do you take seriously? Do you listen to your parents? Do you listen to your grandparents? Do you listen to your teachers in school? Do you listen to your friends in school, or do you listen to other people in school? Do you listen to people on the television, or do you listen to people on the internet maybe? There's so many people who try to tell you all sorts of things, but I wonder, who do you listen to? And maybe a more important question to ask is, how do you know if someone's telling you the truth? How do you know if someone is telling you the truth? There are some people out there who deliberately tell us lies. And there are other people, like us included, that make mistakes and get things wrong. So how do you know if someone's telling you something that they're telling you the truth? That's a really big question. And it's important not just for boys and girls, it's important for everyone. Especially when it comes to thinking about God and what we are to believe about him. If someone's telling you about Jesus and how he saves his people from their sin, how do you know that they're telling you the truth? If someone's telling you about Jesus' life on earth, about his death, about his resurrection, how do you decide that they're telling you the truth? In our reading from the Bible this morning, we read about the Apostle Paul. And Paul was going from town to town preaching the gospel. He was telling people the good news about Jesus. And in the verses we read about two different towns in particular. And the two towns reacted very differently to Paul's preaching and his message about Jesus. Firstly, in a town called Thessalonica, only a few of the Jewish people there were persuaded that Paul was telling the truth. The Jews, most of the Jews, didn't like what Paul had to say. It made them jealous. And instead of believing Paul, instead of listening to him, they actually started a riot. They gathered up a few of the dodgy characters of the town and they got a riot started. And then they blamed Paul and his friends for starting it. The people in Thessalonica are a bad example of how you're to respond when someone tells you about Jesus. But the next town was different. In Berea, the people believed what Paul told them. When Paul came and told them about Jesus, most of the Jews believed him. Most of them believed Paul when he said that Jesus was not an ordinary man. When Paul told them that Jesus was the Christ, that he was the special one, that he was the one that God promised to send years before. He promised to send this one who would save his people from their sin. And when Paul told the people in Berea that Jesus was this special one, they believed him. They believed him. And we read lovely words in Acts chapter 17, verse 11, that they received the message with great eagerness. They really hungered for this word and they wanted more of what Paul was telling them. Young people, and everyone in fact, were you listening carefully to why they received what Paul said? Were you listening as to why they believed him, to how they knew that he was telling the truth? Listen again to chapter 17, verse 11 of Acts. It says, "Now the Bereans were of more noble character than the Thessalonians, for they received the message with great eagerness and examined the scriptures every day to see if what Paul said was true." The Jews in Berea didn't believe Paul because they thought he was a nice man. They didn't just believe Paul because he sounded good and he was a good speaker. They didn't just believe him because, well, other people were believing him, so therefore it must be right. No, the reason why the people in Berea believed Paul and his message about Jesus was because it was the same as what the Bible taught. When they checked out the Bible, they realized that Paul was telling the truth. He was telling the same as what the Bible says. There's something really important here for us to learn. When someone tells us about God, we must check it out with the Bible. If someone tells us something about God or what he requires of us, and it's not in the Bible, then we have no reason to believe it or to seek to follow it. But on the other hand, if someone tells us something about God about what we're to believe about him, about what he requires of us, if they tell us that and it's the same as what the Bible says, then we must, like the Bereans, believe it and receive it with all eagerness. I wonder, in your families, is there ever a row about who sits in what seat in the car? Do you ever have that row? Maybe it was just in our house, but we used to have a fallout when it came to get in the car and go somewhere. Initially, between me and my sister, we used to fall out over who sat in the passenger seat, and as we got a little bit older, we fell out over who was going to sit in the driver's seat. But it's important where you sit in the car, isn't it? Different seats are better than others. Think of all the places, young people, that you could sit in the car. You could sit in the boot, can't you? It's not advisable, it's probably not legal, but you could sit in the boot, and it would be awful. It would be awful because you couldn't see out, you couldn't talk to the driver, you couldn't have really anything to do with the journey. You could sit in the back seat, and that would be better. You could see out, you could talk to the driver, you could maybe tell them where you want to go or what you want to do. They wouldn't necessarily listen to you. You could be just an annoying backseat driver, but you still could talk to them. You could also sit in the passenger seat. The passenger seat is really great. I'm sure there's some boys and girls who love sitting in the passenger seat if you're old enough. It's great because there you get some control. You get to turn the radio up or down. You get to turn the heating on or off. And you get to direct the driver as to where they go. But the best seat in the car has to be the driver's seat. Because there you're in control of everything. There it doesn't matter what everybody else says. You get to decide where you go in the car. You get to decide what speed you go at. You get to decide everything. Because you're in the driver's seat. Why am I talking about a car and seats and different seats? Why am I talking about that? Well, because in a way it's like how people treat the Bible. It's in a way how people treat the Bible. You know, there's some people that don't take the Bible with them at all as they go through life. Some people just forget about it altogether. But more often than not, people take the Bible and they treat it like it's in the boot. They stop and they take it out at special occasions. They read it. They hear it read. But it really means nothing to them. And it makes no difference. Other people treat it like a backseat driver. They have it with them. They listen to it sometimes, but quite often it's just annoying them, and they'd be happier without it. Other people still treat the Bible like a passenger. They allow it some control in their lives. They listen to it in some reasons, and in some for some things. But ultimately, it does not have the prime place in their life. Ultimately, it's not in control of what they believe or what they do. Then there is, of course, the people like the Bereans that we read about in Acts 17. They had the Bible in the driving seat, as it were. The Bible directed them as to what they believed about God. The Bible showed them what was true, and they followed it because they knew that in the Bible God never lies. They knew that if they wanted truth about God, they had to go to the Bible for it, and so they went to it. And they followed it. It's a challenge to us all, isn't it? What place has the Bible in our lives? Are we someone who pays no attention at all to the Bible? Are we someone who is happy to have it out at special occasions, but apart from that, have nothing to do with it? Are we those who listen to it in some ways? A bit like a passenger, you allow it some control of things, but ultimately, it's not in the driving seat. Or are we those like the Bereans that have the Word of God directing us, teaching us, and we are trusting on it to teach us everything? That's a challenge for us, and we need to take that challenge seriously. As I come to a close, there's something that I want to say to Christians here. And I must say it's very obvious in the passage that we read together. For us who love the Bible, who love God's Word, who love to read it, to study it, to hear it read and preached and explained, for us it can be worrying when people oppose the Bible, when people reject it, When people do something like those in Thessalonica and they throw it away and they want nothing to do with it, it can be worrying for us as Christians when we see that. We can be worried about the future of the church as people seem to reject Jesus. We can be worried about God's plans in the world as people refuse to listen to the Bible. But I want to say this to you today, and I want you to remember this, that opposition to Jesus and his word from outside the church will never, ever destroy the church or defeat God's plans. I'm going to say that again because it's important, and this is really what we see in the book of Acts. When people outside the church oppose the Bible and reject Jesus, that will never destroy the church. Because as you read through the book of Acts, and we see it even here in the passage we read together, that even when people outside the church oppose Jesus and reject his word, even then the church continues to grow. And that's the marvelous thing of the book of Acts as you read through it. The apostles went through some horrific things. They were thrown in prison. They were beaten. Some of them were actually killed. And other Christians as well suffered so much as people outside the church opposed God's word and rejected Jesus. But despite of all that, the church continued to grow and the message of the gospel continued to spread. See, that's where the challenge comes for us as Christians. Will we keep the Bible in the driving seat even when it gets hard? Because it will be hard if we claim to love Jesus. Will we keep the Bible in its proper place? See, unbelievers will hate it when God's word is taught. Unbelievers hate being told that they are sinners. Unbelievers hate being told that their sin is a problem with God. Unbelievers hate being told that they can't do anything to save themselves. Unbelievers hate being told that their only hope of salvation is through trusting in a man that died 2,000 years ago on a cross. Unbelievers hate hearing that Jesus is raised from the dead and that he is coming back to judge the world. They hate hearing this, but this is exactly what the Bible teaches. And this is exactly what the Bible tells us that we must teach. And this, whether the world believes it or not, this, what we have in our Bibles, is the only hope for our world. There would be nothing more terrible for us as the church to take the Bible out of its driving seat, out of its proper place, out of directing and guiding all that we think and we do. There is nothing will do the church more harm than when the church forgets the Bible. May we keep the Bible in its proper place to direct us and rule us and show us what to believe and how to behave. Then we'll be like the Bereans that we read about in Acts 17. We will know the blessing of trusting in the man that the Bible is all about. And we will also be a blessing to the whole world that we witness to. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we do thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is true, that it is eternal, that we can trust it, that we can believe it, that we can build our lives upon it. Father, we thank you for the availability of your word, that we can freely read it, and that we can meet here and hear it read and preached. Father, we thank you for that. And we pray that you would continue to shape us by your Spirit in your word. Continue to give us more and more faith in Jesus, who the Bible is all about. Help us to understand difficult parts and help us to obey even when it's difficult. Father, today we want to pray for those in need. And Father, we realize that things aren't normal in our country at the minute. But we also realize that there are people in other parts of the world who are suffering in a much greater way than we are. Father, we pray for them today. We pray for those who are homeless, who have been displaced and driven out from their own land. We pray for those who haven't got the means to even provide food for themselves. We pray for those who are worried and confused about the future. Father, we pray for all these people in need, and we ask that you would help them and help those who seek to help them as well. Father, particularly for the governments of our world, may you give them wisdom in these days. May you help them to use their resources wisely to help those in need. Father, we pray for our own land today, and we thank you for the blessing of being able to meet here for worship today. We pray that you would continue to help our government and all the people in our country as we seek to get through this challenging time. Help us all to be wise, and help us to be faithful to you and to love our neighbours. Father, we pray for this congregation here. We thank you for them. We thank you for each member of it, and we thank you for everybody connected to it. And we pray that you will continue to bless them in these days. Help them to keep the Bible in its proper place. Father, we pray particularly for the minister, Reverend Dr. Jerry Clinton. We thank you for him. We thank you for his faithfulness to you and for all the work that he does here in this congregation. Father, we pray for him especially at this time as he has extra work, as he's looking after the group of churches up at Castle Blaney. Father, help him in that and give him strength to keep going, to serve you with joy and to bring glory to your great name. Father, we offer all our prayers in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. And now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen.